And now, please welcome Annenberg student Monica Alba.
Good evening, and welcome to the inaugural event of the USC Annenberg Distinguished Lectures on Latin American Art and Culture. My name is Monica Alba, and I'm a senior majoring in broadcast journalism at the Annenberg School for Communication. I'm thrilled about the launch of this series, which will seek to illuminate the significance of Latino art and culture at USC and in the greater Los Angeles community. In a city as diverse as Los Angeles, and with the Latino population being the nation's largest and fastest growing minority group, I believe recognizing Latino contributions to the arts is incredibly valuable. California has the largest Latino population of any state, with about 13 million accounting for 36% of the total population. As the daughter of Mexican immigrants, I am very interested in Latino issues at the cultural level that inspire appreciation and reflection, which will hopefully be the outcome of all future events that are a part of this series, as well as the one you're about to enjoy tonight. Julieta Venegas is an incredibly talented musician whose beautiful music and lyrics transcend borders. So I think it's incredibly fitting that she will be sharing her gift with us tonight. Please enjoy it. And now it is my honor to introduce to you the director of this series and Annenberg Communication Professor, Josh Kuhn.
This is amazing. Give yourselves a hand. Welcome. Feels good. I'm really thrilled to see everybody here tonight. It really is a great sign that what we are trying to do with this new lecture series is working. To bring arts and culture from Latin America into the foreground of LA life and into the foreground of life here at USC. First off, tonight, though, would not be possible without the help of so many, including my dean in the Annenberg School, Ernie Wilson, Giovanna and Josh, the incredible staff of USC Spectrum, especially Dane, Juliana, Mexican-American Alumni Association, and perhaps most importantly, all of the young students here tonight, both from USC, but also from Belmont High, Huntington Park High, oh no, Chino, Manual Arts, Cathedral, and students from the Youth Mentoring Connection. It's those students, the Latino students of the future, who inspire this series. And tonight we are honored to have with us one of the most important voices in contemporary popular music, one of the most important voices in Latin American art, and one of Mexico's leading lights of musical innovation, Julieta Venegas. Now, I first met Julieta a long time ago, back when she was known as this like weird new artist in Mexico, when she was a kind of shy and awkward Chavela Vargas with a sequencer and an accordion, or as the US media started calling her, the Mexican PJ Harvey. I knew her back when she was playing for small crowds who loved her alternative takes on Mexican rock styles and loved her for being a young woman unwilling to sacrifice her individual style for the record industry. And I've watched her grow into an artist who now sells out the 10,000 seats of Mexico City's prestigious Auditorio Nacional, who packs audiences in LA and New York and London and Milan, and who just a few months ago was invited to play at the Nobel Peace Prize concert in Oslo, Norway. She went from being a darling of critics to a darling of fans. And along the way, she was accused of going too pop, of getting too big, of earning too many Grammys and MTV awards, like, I don't know, Best Rock Solo Album, Best Solo Artist, Artist of the Year, Best Alternative Latin Album, Best Music Video, Best Latin Pop Album, and looking too happy in her videos. She was accused of no longer being that weird alternative girl that people thought she once was. But along the way, I think what is most impressive about Julieta is that she has ignored all of this and just stayed true to her own musical vision. Whether it's her debut album, whether it's her Latin alternative masterpiece, Buen Invento, whether it's her breakthrough albums like Si or Limón y Sal, or her most recent MTV Unplugged performance, where it became clear in the context of a string section, a horn section, and even somebody playing a saw, that underneath the myths and fictions of labels like alternative and pop and rock, or rock en español, it's either about good songs or it's not. It's either about artistic integrity or it's not. And for the past 11 years, Julieta has been the definition of artistic integrity in Spanish language music, giving us all the gift of great songs. Songs, and I can't stress this enough, that she writes herself. Songs that can shroud themselves in mystery or be the simplest things on earth. Songs that can be off-kilter accordion waltzes or ragged rock workouts or the purest of pop love songs. Songs that she uses to tell her stories that help the rest of us to tell our own. And Julieta brings a unique geography to her music. She is a veteran resident of Mexico City, one of the world's great centers of vibrant urban chaos and creativity, yet she was born in Long Beach. Anybody? But don't get too excited, because forever she will be a daughter of Tijuana. So, where she was raised, in the borderlands of culture, language, and music. I want to just make sure everyone knows that there is no formal concert tonight. Instead, there will be conversation and music, or better, conversation through music. Julieta has been kind enough to agree to let us all into her artistic process, to share the stories of her songs with us, and well, to just kind of hang out with us. I've told her that this room, she should think of it as her living room, and she should feel free to play and talk in ways that are comfortable to her outside of the artifice of putting on a big show. We are all pleased and honored and thrilled that you are all here to join us, so please help me in welcoming to the stage Julieta Venegas.
Hi. I just blushed. Thank you.
Totally like your living room.
Yeah, well, yeah, right.
How does it feel?
Oh, it feels great. I'm really nervous. You guys just made me blush. Thank you for that welcome. Thank you for that speech about me. Thanks. Really
a
excited.
Speech.
Yeah, you
That's
know.
Right.
I don't know. Yeah. I'm happy to be here, thanks.
So we're just going to kind of talk, and as we talk, we're going to maybe hear some stuff on the piano, and I told Julieta if she needs someone to beatbox on any tunes.
Yeah, you're going to do that part, right?
Yeah, I'll do that for you.
So, that should be fun.
Yeah, or really embarrassing. So it's been over 11 years, officially, that you've been making music in terms of putting out records. First record dating back to 1998. In the U.S., at least,
yeah.
Right?
Uh-huh, yeah.
When in Mexico, when did the first record come out?
97.
97. But you've been playing music since you were quite young.
Yeah.
And so, could you maybe talk to, do you have like a first musical memory?
Yeah, actually, I guess it's related to my family. When we were kids, my parents used to take us on trips to San Felipe, which is south of Baja, you know, Baja California, para abajo. And we used to go there every year. That was like a vacation, so we'd go by, we'd travel by car. I don't know, I have no idea how long the trip is, but it seemed eternal to me when I was a kid. And my mom would play, my mom was totally into singing in the car, so she'd play, I remember a lot the José José album, and Rocío Dúrcal singing Juan Gabriel. And... And I was a really grouchy kid, so when they played that, I was really I didn't want to sing with them because everybody would sing along, and I'd be like, I'm not going to do it. And inside I was singing, but I was just like, I'm not going to sing with them. And, but it was like, te pido por favor. Come on. Oh, damn it.
So, the power of Juanga.
Yeah, the power of Juanga just came through me.
Were there other, when you were having these feelings, were there other songs that you wanted to be singing more that you felt like were more your songs than your parents' songs?
No, not when I was really a kid. It was basically, I think, when my brother started developing more of a taste in music that I started copying whatever he was listening to, or maybe choosing from what he was listening to, because I never liked Kiss. I'm sorry. I mean, my brother loved them, but I didn't get into it. I got into Madness, and I got into, I guess, Culture Club. I just, you know, I loved them. And so, but I think that was a little bit later. I'm not sure exactly of dates, but I think my mom was always into singing in the car and always into being like, she'd make us sing, cri cri, or anything just when we were going to school. Caminito de la escuela. And stuff like that. So I think my first musical memories are definitely my mom. You know, she was totally, and she was always singing and stuff like that.
Was there a moment that you knew maybe I should start playing something, or I wanted to sing, or I wanted to learn an instrument? Do you remember some sort of click that went off at some point?
No, I think the click went off when I was actually doing it. Because my parents, they're really strict, and they didn't want us to be sitting around the house, so they made us take lessons of everything they could think of. I mean, they actually took us to cooking lessons. I mean, who wants to learn to cook when they're 10? It's like, God. And they put us in ballet lessons, and they tried everything. And I think I clicked with the piano right away. It was this... But I realized it was easy for me. It was easier for me, and I liked it better than my brothers and sisters. Well, my brother took one class, and he left, and that was it. And my sisters lasted about a couple of years, and until my teacher, who was a great teacher, and I think she's the reason why I'm still doing music, she came to my dad, and she's like, you know what? I don't think your kids really want to be here. Yvonne falls asleep in the class, and, you know, it's a private class, so she falls asleep and she's the only one. And then Janine, you know, neither of them really wanted to be there, and she's the one who told them, but I think Julieta really does want to be here. And that's when I realized, oh my God, yeah, that's true, I do want to be here. Like, yeah, I like it. And I actually found it easy, and even if I didn't study, I'd know what I was doing, and I just realized it was easy for me. And I guess that's when I realized that I was really wanted to keep on doing it.
Now, you mentioned your sister Yvonne. You born a twin.
Yes.
I'm sure everyone knows. How does that, when you look back on it now, being a twin, did that leave any impact, you think, on how you thought of yourself as an artist, or how you developed as an artist in any way? Did it affect the way you thought about writing or singing or anything?
Well, I think that when I first realized that I was becoming an individual was when I was singled out as someone who could make music, or someone who could have a certain como una facilidad to play the piano. So I think being a twin being a twin and being a chaotic kid, you know, como en un lugar caótico lleno de niños, I needed to kind of have my own space and just say that this is what I'm about. And the piano kind of became that. It was my territory. I mean, that big, huge thing was mine. And because my dad basically told me, you know, this is yours now. From now on, this is your piano. And it was like, it was taller than me. So I was like, yeah. And I think the fact that I needed to know that I was an individual kind of helped me to do that. It was like, hey, you know, I'm this. You guys are probably just like this mess, but I'm, you know, I'm the one who plays the piano here.
So you had a piano in the house.
Yeah.
And you had a supportive environment that encouraged you to go forward into music.
Yeah, definitely.
And this was, we should point out, of course, in Tijuana. Mm-hmm. And I'm just wondering, I know this is a question you get a lot, but it's clearly a crucial one for kind of the evolution of your profile as an artist. Is growing up in Tijuana, I mean, this was in the 70s and 80s in Tijuana. Mm-hmm. Could you talk to us about the city's climate then and its role, the kind of the role of a border city in the way that you started to grow as an artist?
Well, it definitely has changed a lot. I guess like any city, but being a border city especially, it has changed a lot, but I just felt like I was in a really small place, you know. It had that feeling. Everybody knew each other, and it was just like. And at the same time, I guess we didn't realize we were living on both sides of the border. It was just so natural. I mean, going to the supermarket or maybe going to the drive-in, because we didn't have drive-ins in Tijuana, so we went to the drive-in movies in San Diego. Or, I mean, we just crossed all the time. I don't even know if we did it every day or not, but we did it a lot. So it was pretty normal.
And this was back when crossing the border was not an entire day's adventure.
Exactly. Right. Right. Sentry didn't exist and all right. that. It was just normal, you know, you just cross all the time.
And so clearly you speak great English. Speaking English has been something that's part of, right? that's been part of your life for a long, long time. And you mentioned Madness and all these other bands that you heard. I mean, that was also part of what Tijuana kind of allows you to do, right? Is to have access to San Diego radio and be able to juggle between Juan Gabriel and Madness.
And watch shows and do all that.
What was your first concert?
I don't even remember. I don't even think it was an English artist. It was probably something my parents took me to or something. I remember going to Parchís, actually.
The Parchís? Yeah. Okay. Which one was your favorite?
What?
Which one was your favorite?
Helado, the blonde guy, David, yeah. but you know what? I think they did a playback.
Shocker.
Shocker. Hey, I thought they were doing it live.
But hey. So that going back and forth, I mean, that has to leave a mark in terms of your ability to juggle different, you know, languages and cultures and styles. And
well, it just all seemed very natural to me, and it still does. I don't really see, because it's not just about understanding the language, but I guess understanding the subtleties in a music that's maybe different, or maybe a rock band. You know, in Tijuana, when I started playing with my first bands, nobody was thinking of doing it in English. Even if we did listen to everything we listened to was in English, but we didn't even think about it. It was like, no, we're gonna do it in Spanish, of course. It's like, you know, Mexicanos, and we, you know, and it's really funny because I guess we never really thought about it like that, like becoming a part. We always knew it was separate, but at the same time we were a part of it as spectators, maybe because we weren't in there exactly. It's kind of weird.
I know. What year did you leave Tijuana for Mexico City?
I guess it was 92 or 93, the end of 92.
And so how old were you?
How old
Can
was
ask you
I?
That question?
Yeah, okay.
you don't have to answer.
I was 21 or about to turn 22.
Okay. So was that that must have been a fairly big, seemed like a big move to go at 21, 22 from Tijuana to Mexico City. Because Mexico City is not a small town like Tijuana was.
Yeah, exactly. And that's exactly what I liked about it. I guess Tijuana's always really far from, you felt very far. I think maybe now the distances don't feel as big.
Right.
But at that point, you were closer, a lot closer to the States and to everything about it. And everything seemed more accessible there than waiting for films to come out in Mexican cinema or in Tijuana. And everything was just so slow and far away. And the first time I went to Mexico City, all of a sudden, like, this whole picture of what my life was about suddenly filled up. And I was like, oh, of course, this is a big city. I mean, this is what I'm about, you know? I just felt like I had to be there. And I just really fell in love with the city. And I just never went back. It wasn't really like, I'm going to go to Mexico City and live. It was like, I went for a vacation. It's like, I'm not going back. You know, I'm going to stay here. And it took a couple of months for me to go back and pick up my stuff, and that was it.
And before you started actually making music that you considered your own music or solo, you know, solo career in that sense, you were actually doing some work with theater companies in Mexico City, right?
Well, actually, I worked with one in Tijuana. The last year that I was there, I worked with a company there, and then when I went to Mexico City, it was only one play that I did, but it was actually the first time I started living with, o sea, como making a living with music, with
right.
making music. So it was, for me, it was a big step. I mean, I didn't realize it at the time, but I mean, I was teaching English. It's ridiculous because I never actually studied English grammar. It was silly, but I had to bluff with something, and since I had the accent, everybody thought I knew what I was doing. So I was like, I taught English for like a year.
And really, they were getting the English you learned from sitcoms.
Well, yeah, they didn't know that, so.
And so then you ended up playing with a band in Mexico City before performing solo, right?
Yeah, I played with a band. I actually did the whole putting flyers up in record stores and putting my number and going, you know, keyboard player, I'm looking for a band, and I write songs, and it's pretty funny. And it actually worked. I mean, now that I think about it, I can't believe I went into all those people's houses. I mean, I went to a bunch of places in Mexico City looking. I went to this drummer's house, and then I went to, I was like, I would do stuff that I'm like, God, that's pretty crazy, you know, just like moving around the city and listening to people play and stuff. And through that, I met a guy who was a guitar player, and we put a band together. So that lasted like about a year. And after that experience, I was done. I'm like, I'm not fit to be in a band. I'm just going to do my songs and go on with that.
What was the name of the band?
Lula.
Lula. And so, do you remember the moment where you, when you were writing and working on music, when you said, "Okay, this is a song that I might want to put out on a record," or this is a Julieta Venegas song?
No, I don't think I ever thought that because I never even thought I was going to do a record. It was I've always just loved writing, and I really never cared about what it was about. It was just like. I did realize there was a difference between what I did by myself and what I did when I was writing with somebody else. You know, it always seemed different. And for some reason, I always came back to the songs that I did by myself. When the bands broke up, the bands I was in, I always went back and played my songs. And I was like, I don't know, they're just different, you know?
And the first song you wrote as a kind of solo tune, you've confessed, was one not one of your finer moments?
No, it was pretty corny, actually. Because when I actually started writing in the first bands that I played with Chantaje and with another one called Set the Bus, the names were pretty funny, and another band I can't even remember the name of, but that was the first time I started writing lyrics and singing, and for me that was basically a really big step from playing classical piano to going into a band and writing. And then the first time, after I started playing with bands at home, I started playing the piano and writing songs at home. And that's, you know, basically when I kind of realized that I was doing something by myself, you know.
So what was the name of the cheesy song?
It was called Esta Imaginación.
Can we hear a little bit?
No, no.
It was about... Sample lyric?
And no.
Just say it. Just speak it.
It was something like, esta imaginación no tiene fronteras, esta imaginación... No, you don't want to know. I mean, really.
Sounds like a Paulina hit.
Oh, my God. Yeah, I'll send it to her, see if she wants to do something with it. Yeah, it was pretty bad. And so I started asking friends to give me lyrics, that basically, because I realized I wasn't ready for it.
And one of the lyrics that you got sent was a poem, correct?
Yeah, a friend of mine from Tijuana... a few friends of mine, actually. Chuy, who was a guitar player for Chantaje, and then another friend whose name was Gustavo, also had a bunch of poems, and I'm like, well, you know, just send them to me and I'll try to make some songs with them.
And what did that song become, that poem?
Well, actually, two of the songs that I did at that time went into the first album. One was Libertad and the other one was Esta Vez. So,
will you play Esta Vez for us?
Yeah, of course.
Cool.
Okay, I hope I don't mess it up.
De un árbol que nada tiene que ver recibo de luz somos servilleta y el recibo de luz esta vez somos de papel somos las infracciones Esta vez somos honestas. Somos servilleta y el recibo de luz. Somos servilleta y el recibo de luz. Esta vez somos de papel, somos las infracciones. Esta vez somos honestos. Para siempre, para siempre, yeah, oh, yeah. Hiende, 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 hiende.
Not bad, not bad.
Thanks.
I mean, what people I think also have to realize is what in this, the song, the record that this song came out on, your first record, Aquí, in 1998, when this record came out, at least to my ears, and I think to most people's ears, nothing like it had existed at all that sounded like this record in the world of Mexican rock, let's say. It was something that was a voice and it was a sound to your songs that no one had heard before. And I think was one of the things that started captivating people's ears, you know, about your work. But this was also a record that you recorded this all in Mexico City?
No, I recorded it in Los Angeles, actually.
All of it in Los Angeles.
Yeah.
Produced by Gustavo Santaolalla.
Yeah.
Now, Gustavo Santaolalla is someone who now is probably one of the most well-known composers and film scores and producers in the world, Oscar-winning. But first was really best known as you know, an Argentinian hippie rocker, and then rock en español producer. How'd you hook up with him?
I met him through Café Tacuba because at that time, yeah, they're cool. Anyway, but I met actually Café Tacuba are probably the first band I met in Mexico City when I was playing with Lula. They actually showed up at one of the shows. Which to me was a shock that they actually found out. They found out through a friend of a friend of a friend, and it was like the big deal for us that they showed up. And I met them, and I started going out with Joselo, the guitar player. And it was, you know, I mentioned him because he was really important, and he's still a great friend of mine, and I'm still a big fan of theirs. But I think he had a lot to do with the fact that I decided not to play with bands anymore. It was like, what are you doing playing with bands? I mean, just do whatever you want to do. And I was, because I always kept on telling him, I want to play the accordion and I want to do something different and do something else. And he's like, buy an accordion. And I was like, oh, okay, I'm going to try that. And stuff like that. And through him is that he's the one who told Gustavo about me and gave him like one of my four-track demos that I was doing at that point. And Gustavo liked it. And Gustavo was like, you know what, I'm really interested in keeping in touch with you and knowing what you're doing. And what's going on, and then about a couple, I don't know, must have been like a year or a year and a half later that when I got signed, he already knew that he wanted to do the record with me, and I knew that. And the record company knew, so we're all in the same, you know, wavelength, and so it was cool.
I mean, I remember hearing "Oportunidad," the first song on that record, played on KCRW in '99 on LA radio. And KCRW and other stations like that in the U.S. were very supportive early on of your first record. And it started to set up a relationship that you had with the U.S. that I think a lot of other artists in Mexico didn't have. And I'm just wondering, at that point in your career, was the U.S. as a market something that actually entered your brain, or were you just trying to get through the record?
Well, I didn't even... this is the first time anybody's told me that album in particular was played in KCRW. I thought they started playing me in the second one. So, you know, this is news for me.
There you go.
And no, I didn't even know if I was ever going to go play. I just wanted to come play in Los Angeles. It was like, God, can't we go there? And we couldn't. I mean, the first time I played was after the whole thing with the whole first album cycle was done. A friend of mine, Alex Zuniga, actually went, "No, we have to go play in LA." And he put a show together. That was a really tiny show.
Alex Zuniga put a show together?
What?
I can't believe he actually put a show together.
Yeah, he did. Yeah. And I came and I did a show by myself. That was the first time I ever played here with my own stuff. Mm-hmm. And it was just with the drum machine, the keyboard, and the accordion. And that was my first show.
In LA?
In LA. So.
Do you remember what club?
No, it was really tiny, but I can't remember where.
Were there people there?
There was actually people. There were like, but there weren't that many. I mean, there were enough to hear claps when they were, you know, clapping. But it was, I don't know, it must have been like 20 or 30 people.
All right.
You know, so we put a crowd together.
You have like 25 or 35 now.
That's a crowd.
Yeah, totally. So how you've recorded this first record, the critics start writing about you as, you know, this kind of next big thing and this new artist in the alternative world. And so how what's the process from the first record to the second, which is by all accounts the toughest move to make?
I totally agree. I think the second album is the hardest one. I mean, it was for me, and every time I hear a second album by an artist, I'm like, I've been there. I know what you're going through. You know, it's hard. It's because the first record, everybody says that it's because you have all your life to write the first record and then just a few months to write the second one. That's not it. When you're doing the songs for the first record, you don't even know you're doing songs for a record. It's like you have no consciousness of what it's about, or putting, unless you really know what you're doing, which I didn't, you know? I mean, it was, when I started working on the songs for the second album, I had no idea, because people can perceive you and talk about you and say, oh, she's this, she's that, but I didn't think about myself like that. I was like, what do I want to do now? I have no idea, you know? And when I started writing the songs for it, at that point in my life, I don't know, now I feel that I was doing really complicated songs, and it was more about the chord movements than about the songs themselves or about the melodies or about the stories. And but I didn't realize it at that time. At that time, I thought I was doing a rock record. I really felt like doing it, because I don't think I ever was rock in the sense, traditional sense. I mean, I'm a pianist, beginning, you know, with that. It's not easy to be, you know. I mean, if you're not a guitar, electric guitar, and I was never like that. And then, in the second, when I started writing the second album, I started playing guitar, and I think that started defining what I was going towards. And I started listening to Charlie Garcia obsessively, and I think that also kind of moved it along. And so,
it's funny that you think about that now as a rock record. If you go back and listen to it, I mean, what made it such a masterpiece, I think, for a lot of people in Rock en Español, is that you didn't attack anything straight on. That the notes you played, the melodies, the choruses were all just a little bit not where people expected them to be. And you sang in ways that would often defy expectations, which nobody was doing at that time. So even if you go back now and listen to that record, it sounds very different, obviously, than some of your newer stuff, but has that sense of adventure and experimentation.
Yeah, and I think that I didn't realize, I think I was experimenting, but I didn't realize it at the time. I thought I was doing something totally straightforward. I thought it was, oh yeah, this is easy.
Would you play a song off the record for us?
Sure.
How about Casa Abandonada?
Casa Abandonada, okay, let me just say something about that song. I've been playing it now these last few days. For some reason, I feel very distant to Buenimento, the spirit of it. And I like the what I was doing that, but it's like a picture you see and you're like, why did I wear that hair? You know, that kind of thing. I like it a lot, but I don't feel close to the songs because I think when I try to play them, I have a hard time. You know, it's like there's a lot of chord movements that for some reason, now I think I really thought about them a lot when I was doing it. I didn't realize it at the time, but now.
So the chord movements themselves.
Basically what I'm saying is I might mess it up, you know?
How about this? Instead of playing the whole song, could you actually show the audience what for you is a difficult set of chords or what makes the song tricky?
Okay, I'll do that and they'll play the song and then they'll see. You'll see.
Okay. Okay. Fair enough.
Okay, what I mean when I say complicated, I mean, the chords aren't complicated themselves because they're really just all straightforward major chords. What I mean is that I do sort of like, I don't know how you'd say it in English, trabalenguas. You know how when you say like a really complicated phrase, just to kind of, that's what I do, but chord-wise. So I do like, in the chorus, I'll do something like, this, for some reason, is hard for me to play and sing at the same time. Okay, I'm gonna try to play it, okay? But don't, you know, just don't. You've been warned.
Abandonada, nadie para decir algo sobre ti. Oh, ¿dónde estabas? Nada. Hoy llamé a casa abandonada. Si no contestan hoy, ¿cuándo lo harán? ¿Cuándo? Llamo otra vez, días después, igual, larga distancia evita, te pueda tocar. Y si salieron a otra ciudad, ¿por qué no avisaron? Después de la señal, su necesidad, tu voz me arregla, oh, como nueva flor. Y si salió hoy, ¿con quién y para qué? Y si habló, ¿con quién y de qué? Y si salió hoy, ¿con quién y para qué? Y si habló, ¿con quién y de qué? Ausencia, no puedo respirar, de las paredes brota arañas desde el momento en que te vas. Hoy llamé a casa abandonada, tiempo que pasa estabilidad, ay, llamé a casa desesperada, el tiempo que toma tu llegada me mata. Y si salió hoy, ¿con quién y para qué? Y si habló, ¿con quién y de qué? Y si salió hoy, ¿con quién y para qué? Y si habló, ¿con quién y de qué? Y si salió, ¿con quién? casa abandonada, casa abandonada.
I told you.
Thank you for trusting us.
Should I stay here? Should I go over there?
You want me to come over there?
Okay.
Yeah. Right.
You can't sit on the thing, on the cover. That'd be cool. Like Michelle
like
Pfeiffer
Michelle
in that
Pfeiffer.
Film.
I was
you know?
Just going to say that.
Yeah.
Do you remember a conversation we had many, many years ago when you told me that once When a Mento had come out and you had been doing a lot of press, that a lot of people in the media would say at press conferences to you, but do you write your own songs?
Yeah.
You really write your own songs? Was that something that was happening a lot, that people couldn't believe that a young woman was writing her own songs?
That's something that still happens.
Still happens.
Still have to say I write my own songs. It's pretty silly, but yeah, it's kind of frustrating sometimes.
And that male performers do not get.
The what?
Male performers do not get that question.
I guess they don't. Do they? I don't think so. Not as much. I mean, I think now a lot more people know that I'm, you know, also a writer. But yeah, definitely with the first and the second album, and I was like, who's gonna write these songs anyway? I mean, what? A record company guy's gonna go like, please write this song for my artist? I mean. God, I was doing, you know, I mean, Casa Abandonada, hello.
Imagine someone writing those chords for you.
Yeah, write a really difficult chorus, you know, it did seem kind of obvious, like, you're a girl, so I guess somebody's doing that stuff for you, and yeah, it was a little bit frustrating.
I mean, I know in the early days you always got the women in rock question,
yeah.
So I won't ask that exact question, but I do think it's important for people to hear a little bit about any thoughts that you had in those early years, because things have changed a lot in terms of the presence of women in particularly Latin music, and now there are far more women making music than there were before.
Yeah.
But was that something that was a kind of daily challenge, or is that something you just kind of shrugged off?
I guess I shrugged it off, especially because I think when being a woman in rock, for me at least, was a very easy experience. I think that was actually the easiest part, because I would open for bands, I don't know, even in Tijuana, when I was doing just solo piano stuff that I was opening for bands, people were really open about it. They were like, oh, she's playing a piano by herself. Okay, that should be interesting. And they were curious about it. It I'm sure it was much easier in those sort of places than what it would have been like in even, I don't know, pop world or whatever. It was really easy, and people were curious and wondering what I was doing sitting there with an accordion and a drum machine, and they were like going, oh, this is good. And I had their attention at least for the first few songs. They were curious about it. And so I think it was easy for me. I think it's hard for anybody who's doing something personal and something that they're not following a pattern or something. And I think I was, you know, I've always felt that just being a writer and something kind of gets you into that direction. But it wasn't particularly hard for me because I was a woman. Actually, I was very lucky about always having people surrounded by people who really respected me, working with Gustavo, who was really respectful to me as an artist and just gave me a lot of space and actually made me realize stuff that I didn't even realize I was doing, and going like, look, you're doing this, this is good. And I was like, oh, okay, thanks, you know, and even being surrounded by people who really respected, even musicians who started playing with me. At first they started doing it, you know, just for free because they liked what I was doing. So that was good. I felt really privileged in that sense.
I mean, we all know that you know, no songwriter or no writer writes in a vacuum. I mean, you're taking in other kinds of information beyond just turning your own, let's say, romantic foibles into songs. But, you know, one thing that I don't know if a lot of people know about you is you are a voracious reader. That you read a lot, particularly of fiction.
Yeah.
Is that something that plays a part in how you think of song? Like, have you learned from novelists? Have you learned from short story writers at all in how you write songs?
Yeah, I think, yeah, definitely. I have a thing with language. And when I write songs, I do both the lyrics and the music at the same time. I mean, I might have a phrase that I'll develop later, but I think there is something about the telling of a story that I love about a song. I don't think that I'm not into I've always written like that. I've always liked a story in a song, even if it's just like a picture and just like saying, this is it, but describing something. And I'm not good at anecdotes. I'm not like, I woke up this morning and I went to the supermarket or something in a song, but I like the voice that's
talking.
Thank God. the voice that's talking, I like it to have, you know, sort of like a beginning and an end, just something that makes sense. And that's definitely from the fact that I love stories and I love language and I just love being able to develop something in my own little way, just a tiny little story in a song, you know.
I have a surprise for you.
You have a surprise
for me? Yeah, so hold on 1 second. We have a small gift. So this is per your love of fiction. Okay, you guys want to see Julieta the reading geek? Here we go.
Oh my God.
They told you.
Oh my God, invisible man, I didn't find it today. Oh my, these are a lot. These are a lot, thank you. Cool.
She's been on a kick of reading 19th century and 20th century American and British literature.
Oh, thank you.
We expect full book reports.
Okay.
You'll come back next year and give us book reports.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So you talked about the process of writing, so you can put them down. They're not going anywhere. They're yours.
Okay,
just a prop. There's just like eggs in there. You talked about the process of writing a song. Is there a song that you could maybe walk us through a little bit about how it was written? Maybe just a little bit of the steps of how any particular song came together?
Sure. Which one? Well, there's a Me Voy that I wrote basically all in one sitting.
In one sitting.
Yeah. Because I felt like doing a. I was like, I feel like doing una de tres cuartos. And then it was like, I don't know what I was going through then, but I think it was pretty personal. I'm not sure what it was about. And I was like, this, you know, I kind of thought I'd put a little bit of humor into it. And I thought, when you break up, I don't think you should be all depressed about it. You should be, you know, just kind of go and get drunk or do something else. You know? Something like that. Oh, they relate, huh? and so I was like...
And I should say, for the junior high and high school students who are here, getting drunk is Spanish for reading literature.
But also, since I started writing it, I felt like this is something that I really want to put humor into it, and I want to feel like I can sing it with my friends in a bar. Which is something I have to confess I never do. I never go with my friends to a bar, but for some reason it was like the image that I wanted to have when I was writing it. And so, you know, I started, should I just play it or should I just...
Yeah, pretend we're your friends.
What?
Pretend we're your friends at the bar. Go for it.
With my friends, okay. So, it started in the piano and then I passed it on to the guitar, but I'm just gonna do it on the piano.
Porque no supiste entender a mi corazón lo que había en él, porque no tuviste el valor de ver quién soy. Escuchas lo que está tan cerca de ti, solo el ruido de afuera y yo, que estoy al lado, desaparezco para ti. No voy a llorar y decir que no merezco esto, porque es probable que lo merezco, pero no lo quiero, por eso me voy. Que la me despido de ti y me voy. Qué lástima, pero adiós, me despido de ti. sepa darme amor, desde que endulza la sal y hace que salga el sol. Yo que pensé, nunca me iría de ti, que es amor del bueno de toda la vida, pero hoy entendí que no hay suficiente para los dos. No voy a llorar y decir que no merezco esto, porque es probable que lo merezco, pero no lo quiero, por eso me voy.
Well, but we were going to talk about the process. And,
right.
I usually write with a drum machine. I always have a drum machine around, and or even a sound metronome.
When you say drum machine, what era are we talking about?
Like, what era?
Is it a new one, or is it, you know, kind of a classic little Casio?
No, it's a new, sort of semi-new. It's more about just having a certain, it's even sometimes about the timbres. That's why sometimes I can do it with a metronome, but it's also pretty fun to do it with a, you know, just putting an actual beat. And with this one, it was hard for me to put a three, four beat together, so I just didn't, you know, I was just like, I'll put the click on and I'll just play over it. But, I was saying that I wanted it to be kind of like funny in a way, for me anyway. I needed humor at that moment. I think this one I really did do it actually. I did do it in a sitting. I mean, I started doing, it started kind of taking me from one part to the next. I just had like the first part, the porque no supiste entender a mi corazón. I was really just telling, like, mira, no supiste ni qué hacer, ni pelaste, cabrón. Así que. And I was like, how do I say that, you know, subtly? So I'm just being kind of. So that's when, and then when I, and also I thought about the ranchero songs from the 70s, you know, like Lucha Villa and people like that, who were like, always seemed like they were singing drunk. You know, I was always like, yeah, you know. So that's, for some reason, I always thought about them when I was doing this part, the no voy a llorar y decir, because when you're saying, you know, I'm not going to cry and say, because you're not going to be you're not going to play the victim. You're like saying, you know, pues no me voy a hacer la víctima, y probablemente yo también ya la regué, and I hurt a lot of people, and I made my mistakes, but I'm not staying for this. So, you know, so that was basically it.
Thank you for sharing.
Oh, sure. Hey, you know, it saves therapy.
You know, there's like 1,300 people here. Okay. So the record that song was released on, Limón y Sal, really couldn't have been possible without the record before it in many ways, Sí.
Yeah, definitely.
Which, and I think it's safe to say that Sí was a breakthrough record for you. It changed your career. It's a record that took you to heights of popularity, mainstream popularity, that your previous two records didn't even come close to.
Definitely.
And some critics were less than happy with that move and thought that you had gone from being alternative to becoming a pop star. And I'm just wondering, I know you've got strong feelings about what it means to make pop music. And I'm just wondering, when you were putting C together, could you share with us your thought process about how your sound was changing and what it meant to you?
Well, I think it happens with all records. I don't think C could have existed without Buen Invento. I mean, I played Buen Invento for, must have been like 2 years live. And when I was playing it live was when I realized how complicated it was. Not only because, I mean, the crowd was great, always in the shows, but I didn't feel like I was connecting with them because they were really cool and they were really warm all the time and respectful, but they didn't sing along anything. It was like, they're really into it, but nobody really, and I was like, I felt isolated, you know. Maybe for some writers it's okay to write and have people just listen and not participate, but, and it probably wasn't like that for me before, but that's the point in my life when I realized that I wasn't getting through. That, I mean, it's cool to write for yourself when you're, you know, inside, and but it's also cool to write to be able to communicate when you're writing and to be able to connect. And the lack of that was what I felt at, when I didn't have it. And at some point I realized it wasn't happening. And that's when I realized that Buen Invento had been a complicated album. Also playing it, we were very busy. I mean, it was like we were doing all the and trying to, you know, and singing and doing, and all the musicians, all of us were like, okay, we're all into whatever, because it was a hard record to play, but I didn't know, you know, I had to play it to realize that. And when I started writing songs after I finished the tour, it wasn't even an official tour, it was just, we did shows and then stopped and did shows. And when I started to write again, I don't know, for some reason it was like, the first thing I thought was like, I'm not going to do something as complicated, I don't feel like it. And I don't feel like writing in that mood, in that heartbroken mood, although I still do that a lot, but the mood of Buen Invento was very,
dark record in some
ways.
Yeah,
it was dark, and and the songs, the spirit of the songs was always brokenhearted and sort of muy melancólico. And when I started writing the new songs, it was like, I don't feel like doing that. I did that already. I've done it too many times, and I want to write about, how come I've never been able to write something else? Maybe I want to write about something, being happy or expressing sweetness. For me, at that point, it was like, can I do that? Thank God. So when I started writing the songs for C, I was conceptually in my mind, I knew I wanted to go in a different direction, but I kept on doing songs and more songs and started writing like for a year and trying to figure out which direction I wanted to take. But I think the real change, the real point that I realized that things were coming differently was when I sat down to write with Coti. And that was, I was like, when we started writing, I was like kind of scared.
Explain who Coti is for those who don't know.
Sorry? Oh, Coti is he's an artist, but he's also, you know, he's a really good pop songwriter. He's completely pop.
In Argentina.
From Argentina, yeah. Another friend, well, actually my manager is the one who's like, why don't you sit down with him? I mean, try it, you know, you never know. And we sat down to write together, and we really clicked it, because he came from a totally pop world, and I was coming from a totally different sort of, world. and when we sat down together, it's like we kind of balanced out what we both kind of wanted, and it worked really well. And that's basically when I realized what I really wanted to go on with C.
What was there a first song that was the first of the C songs?
Yeah, it was Lento.
Lento?
Yeah, and we actually, it was, no, but I mean, when I say we clicked, we really clicked. I mean, we did like 6 songs in 6 days, and we did half of the album in those 6 days, and I really liked all the songs, and it's something that I'm sure I would not have done by myself. It's just, somebody had to push me into a different direction, because by myself, I was just kind of like going in circles and wanting to go to somewhere else, but when we sat down, it was like, hey, this is, I was kind of scared because I was like, "Está fresa, pero no," but I like it.
Can we hear it?
I had like opposite feelings. I was like, "I love it, I hate it. I love it, I hate it." And then yeah, just so.
From those opposites come the best stuff.
Yeah.
You know? So will you play it for us?
Yeah, of course. Okay.
Si quieres un poco poco de mí, me deberías esperar y caminar a paso lento, muy lento. Y poco a poco olvidar el tiempo y su velocidad, frenar el ritmo, ir muy lento, más lento. Ser delicado y esperar, dame tiempo para darte todo lo que te. Un poco de mí, dame paciencia y verás, será mejor que andar corriendo, levantar vuelo y poco a poco olvidar el tiempo y su velocidad, frenar el ritmo, ir muy lento, más lento. Ser delicado y esperar, dame tiempo para darte todo lo que tengo. Ser delicado y esperar, dame tiempo para darte todo lo que tengo. Si suavizas mi vida, no estaré más tiempo sin saber qué siento. Ser delicado y esperar, dame tiempo para darte todo lo que tengo. Ser delicado y esperar.
How are you feeling over there?
Okay.
I remember it was on the tour for that, or one of the tours for the C record. I was lucky enough to be able to go on tour with you guys for about 2 weeks and just kind of watch and observe. And one of the things that was clear on that tour when your audience shifted was that your fan base was a little bit different. And I started seeing, and I know you started seeing, a lot more young women in the audience. Young women in the audience, and sometimes so young that it was their moms who were with them in the audience. And at some of the shows, the entire front row would be, you know, teenage girls with their cell phones up taking pictures. And I'm just wondering, when you started realizing that, did the issue of being a woman singing this music to these young Latina girls in places like Fresno, or, you know, up and down the 101 circuit, did suddenly something, was there ever a moment of a feeling of a responsibility, or that you realized you were being seen by these young girls in a particular way?
Well, yeah. I mean, I don't know if I actually became conscious of it. What I felt was what I was telling you before, like I was connecting, and that, mm-hmm. and that I realized that more than feeling responsible, because I don't know if I've ever felt in a position like, oh, I'm responsible of them. It was more like, hey, you know, yeah, I got through. Yeah, hi. You know, it was like, I really, really felt like I was finally saying something that was mine, and at the same time I could kind of share with, you know, just, it sounds pretty hippie, huh, the share. But yeah, it was, you know, that's what it's about. I think music is definitely communicating. It's definitely telling stories and feeling them so much that they're mine, but at the same time having other people make them theirs. And in that sense, it was, you know, it was cool when I started realizing what was going on and seeing all these girls, and I was like, oh, okay, I get it, you know, especially because the songs that I wrote at that point were very much about just being independent and not loving in a traditional way, but going like being a strong person and kind of going about what you want. And I was like, oh, okay. So all, you know, young women kind of connected with that, because they were like, yeah, that's, you know, I know this because they told me, a lot of people told me like, yeah, you know, that's what I'm thinking, you know, that's what I'm feeling, and it's cool, you know. So it was great.
And a lot of what they're connecting on were love songs, songs about, but optimistic ones. But by the time you get to the next record, the Limón y Sal,
they're not so optimistic anymore.
No, I mean, you go from the cover of C in a wedding dress, right, to Limón y Sal, where the first big single is, you know, I'm kind of tired of love songs.
Oh, yeah, because, I think I did become it a little bit. You mean Canciones de Amor, right? Mm-hmm. When I wrote that song, I was actually writing a love song. I was going, like, see, you know, I was saying something like super sweet and te adoro. No, I never say that, but, you know, I was trying to say something really sweet, and it was like, scratch that. I don't feel like writing this. I was like, no, I'm going to write something else. And I felt like being a little bit more ironic about the idea of a love song. So,
would you play a couple songs from Limón y Sal?
Of course.
From that record?
Do you want me to do Canciones de Amor?
That'd be great.
Well, anyway, this Canciones de Amor is actually a song that I wrote in the piano, but then I passed it on to the guitar. So I don't know if it's going to sound funny in the piano, but, you know, this is the way I wrote it. So. Decías que nada te haría cambiar, y yo te decía que cambiaste todo para mí. Tú me decías que estabas triste con la vida, pero yo nunca te creí. Estoy tan cansada de las canciones de amor, siempre hablan de final feliz. Bien sabemos que la vida nunca funciona así. Yo te mandaba las señales que se me ocurrían, tú nunca las entendías, no escuchabas bien. Un día me cansé y claro está que te dejé. No me hacías caso entonces, ¿para qué? Estoy tan cansada de las canciones de amor, siempre hablan de un final feliz. Bien sabemos que la vida nunca funciona así. Habría hecho todo, pero tú nunca entendiste nada, nada de nada. La vida siempre tiene que seguir, aunque mi corazón se parta y no quede nada.
Por eso estoy tan cansada de las canciones de amor. Siempre hablan de un final feliz. Bien sabemos que la vida nunca funciona así. Nunca funciona así. Nunca funciona así.
You want to sing another from Limón y Sal? How about the title track, actually? We should talk about the title track from that record. Because that, now you co-wrote that song.
I co-wrote it, yeah. Yeah, with an ex-boyfriend. You're giving me that smile.
Insider information.
Yeah.
That's it?
No, okay, no. No, actually, we wrote it long distance. As was the relationship, so, you know, it was easy. But
is it over email?
No, it was actually by phone.
Okay.
No, it wasn't, you know, the thing is that he had this chorus that I really liked, but he didn't really know what to do with it. So one day I told him, you know what, I'm writing and I'm really kind of on a roll here, so why don't you send me that chorus along and I'll see what I can do with it. And so he sent it and I basically just kind of like wrote the song around the chorus that he had, and it was actually pretty easy. It's the best way to definitely collaborate with somebody you're going out with. Long distance, that's like the best way. I recommend that.
And the best part is sometimes the songs outlive the relationships.
Yeah!
Yeah.
Okay, well. Es que estoy como pensando en inglés y en español. Okay, yeah. Okay.
Tengo que confesar que a veces no me gusta tu forma de ser. Luego te me desapareces y no entiendo muy bien por qué. No dices nada romántico cuando llega el atardecer. Te pones de un humor extraño con cada luna llena al mes. Pero a todo lo demás le gana lo bueno que me das. Solo tenerte cerca siento que vuelvo a empezar. Yo te quiero con limón y sal. Yo te quiero tal y como estás. No hace falta cambiarte nada. Yo te quiero si vienes o si vas. Si subes y bajas. Si no estás seguro de lo que sientes. Confesarte ahora, nunca creí en la felicidad. A veces algo se le parece, pero es pura casualidad. Luego me vengo a encontrar, con tus ojos me dan algo más. Solo tenerte cerca, siento que vuelvo a empezar. Yo te quiero con limón y sal. Yo te quiero tal y como estás. No hace falta cambiarte nada. Yo te quiero si vienes o si vas. Si subes y bajas. Si no estás seguro de lo que sientes. Yo te quiero con limón y sal. Yo te quiero tal y como estás. No hace falta cambiarte nada. Yo te quiero si vienes o si vas. Si subes y bajas. Si no estás seguro de lo que sientes. Yo te quiero con limón y sal. Yo te quiero tal y como estás. No hace falta cambiarte nada. Yo te quiero si vienes o si vas. si subes y bajas, si no estás seguro de lo que sientes. Solo tenerte cerca, siento que vuelvo a empezar.
You're trying to escape the piano bench. You're trying to escape the bench. Thank you for playing that one.
Nah.
Now, last year, you put out, you recorded a DVD for MTV, an unplugged concert. Which was kind of a career retrospective in a lot of ways. I mean, it covered songs from throughout your career, and but did them in ways that had we'd never heard before, with different arrangements, different kinds of instruments. And I'm just wondering if you could talk a little bit about, and I know you worked really hard and stressed out a lot about that record. About
you heard a lot of demos. You and Ceci heard a lot of demos.
I know that you worried about and thought hard about how to do those arrangements. And I'm just wondering, what did you learn about yourself in revisiting your career and revisiting those songs and performing them in new ways?
Well, I think I really just focused on the arranging, which is really fun. And it was a lot of work, but at the same time, I've just learned a lot about the sort of like the production side and the arranging side, which I had always done, but this time putting it together for other people to play was really a big step for me, because I've always done the arrangements or worked on the arrangements in my albums, but then I play them, or just, you know, some guy comes in and plays them, or it's all very closed up. This time I was like, put it together to have other people play it, and that was really exciting because it's kind of putting this orchestra together and making the whole thing work, working with Jax Morellenbaum, who was the co-producer and who arranged with me like all the strings and he wrote all the parts for the strings and the wind instruments. And it was exciting, you know. It was being stuck in my house for a couple of months trying to put it together and then opening it up. I don't know about revisiting the songs if it was. I've never been into listening to my stuff. I've never been into like getting home and saying, "Oh, I'm going to listen to my first album," or "Oh, I'm going to," you know. And it even happens to me that if I'm in a place and they play one of my songs, I'm really uncomfortable. And it's sometimes I know sometimes it happens and I know that people do it in a nice way, but I get really nervous. I'm like, I can't do anything. I can't talk. I'm like, I'm just waiting for the song to end. It's just weird. I have this strange insecurity that I can't listen to my stuff, and so I never do. And revisiting a lot of the songs for this album was like listening to songs for the first time in 10 years, or if I hadn't played them, it was like, I don't know, a long time, you know. So some of them I could freshen. I just was like, well, you know, I can do whatever I want to. Sometimes I even changed some of the harmonies in them, and I even messed around with the melodies and some of it. I guess it was because they were my songs. I probably wouldn't have done it with anybody else's, but with mine, it was like, I can mess around with this, and I didn't want to leave them. I couldn't leave them exactly the same.
But when you do a new arrangement for a song that you already recorded and have already played in certain ways, I mean, it's like rewriting a part of a novel or rewriting a short story with the same content, but just rethinking it in different ways. Were there songs that when you were giving them new arrangements that you started to like more than you had before, or like less? Were there things that you started to learn about your songs that you didn't know before in any case?
Well, I think being the way that I am, I found more things that I didn't like than stuff that I did like. So I tried to kind of work around the things that I didn't like. It's hard to explain what they were, because they're just specifics about the writing itself that, I mean, for example, I only put in one song of Buen Invento. I guess that kind of says, well, you know, what I was saying, that I feel very distant to the emotion of the songs and the construction of them. So, you know, that's basically why there wasn't more songs of Buen Invento. There was more of Aquí, and there was actually a couple of songs. And maybe because they're just so far away that I've just felt I could do whatever I wanted to with them. And But I don't know if I like them more. I don't think I like them more. I never like my songs more than when I first write them. When I write them, it's like the best song I've ever done. And it can be like 2 hours later, it's like, oh God, I have to throw this away, scratch it. I hate it. It's the worst song I've ever, you know. But I think the best moment of a song of mine is when I first write it. It's like, wow, this is, or not, wow, this is great. I don't think I ever think that, but it's like, oh, you know, I'm really liking this, and I'm really happy, and I have this adrenaline, which I read in a book somewhere that it's actually endorphins. Kind of something your brain does, something when you're creating stuff that you feel like, yeah, this is great. When that go como cuando se me quita eso, and I'm confronted to the song, it's like, oh God, that was all. You know, it's like when you're drunk, and the next day you kind of see, you know, the next day you see the, you know, you see what you thought was great, and you're like, oh,
do we need to have a conversation here?
Sorry, I was just pretending, you know, putting.
You're worrying me.
No, I'm trying to. I was just, I don't know, poner un ejemplo. I don't know, but you know, you get really carried away with what you're doing, and then you think it's great, and then, oh, never mind.
One of the things for me in hearing the Unplugged songs, what is striking is there's a level of maturity to them. That songs that you thought you understood and knew were revealed to be a lot more complicated or a lot more flexible or a lot more kind of majestic than they had been before because of the new arrangements. And there's a kind of, I don't know, there's a kind of adult quality in some way to this project, which makes sense. I mean, you are older now than you were when you started writing. Right. And I'm just wondering, as someone who's now been putting out records for 11 or 12 years, who's touring now more than you ever toured when you were in your 20s.
Yeah.
I mean, is that stuff that you think about, a kind of about maturity or being a more adult songwriter? Does it just mean you want to go to bed earlier on tour? By the way, we are both past our bedtimes.
We're both definitely past our bedtimes. And I have 2 hours more, so you can imagine. Ooh. No, but, well, first of all, I don't think I've ever gone to bed late on tour ever, so that doesn't make any difference. I think that more than thinking in, you know, with maturity or whatever, it's more, I feel like every record I dare to go a little bit further into, you know, just, I don't know, start opening territory up, because I'm just really curious about trying stuff. And actually, when I started with the whole Unplugged thing, it was because I'm the one who kind of, you know, como le tiré la piedrita a MTV. I was like, no, what do you guys think if I kind of, you know, do this? And because I was curious about it, I was like, I had no idea how people even started thinking or doing it or how they went around to it. And I was kind of curious about it. So that's basically why I started putting it together. So, you know, it was out of curiosity. And I think it's just sort of that, just kind of like going a little bit further. And I think for me, this doing this album was also doing that. It's going further, you know?
So before I ask you to play some of the new songs, I thought maybe we could get some questions from people in the audience.
Yeah.
Who might have better questions than I have.
Nah, cool.
So let's see. We've got two microphones toward the front here. I'd love to actually hear from some of the students in the house as well. Got two mics up in the front. And if you could tell us your name and... We can't hear you. Hold on a sec.
Hello?
There you go.
My name is Berenice Bautista, and I came with Youth Mentoring Connection. Y yo te quería preguntar, ¿cuándo... ¿cómo te das cuenta que tus canciones no solamente son para ti, pero que las tienes que compartir con tu público y hacer que tu público las sienta?
Pues creo que era un poco lo que platicábamos hace rato, como de la sensación y las ganas como de comunicar algo. Pero tengo que confesar que cuando hago alguna canción es un proceso completamente egoísta. No pienso en quién la va a escuchar, si a alguien le va a gustar. O sea... Es muy personal ese momento. No es, de hecho, creo que nunca he pensado como, a ver, a menos de que escriba una canción pensando en alguien, incluso ni eso, a veces ni eso. O sea, es como muy, de repente dije, no, o sea, es como un desahogo personal. Y más adelante, creo que lo llego a pensar o lo llego a sentir cuando estoy tocando en un show, cuando toco una canción en un show y siento que la gente como que le llegó, es, digo, como, o sea, no es algo que pienso conscientemente, pero es algo que siento, como de, sí te emociona sentir que estás como llegándole a alguien, ¿no? O cuando alguien llega y te dice, esa canción es mía, y dices tú, sí, es tuya, qué cool.
Hello, my name is Amado Galaviz, and I came with a good friend of mine who's a USC alumni. My question is in regarding to your creative process. You mentioned that when you sit down and write and compose, you like to have a metronome or a drum machine. How much does a percussive element come into part in your creative juices when you come up with, when you write a song and you create the melody and the chords? Is it in there, the creative process, or more like, okay, I'm done with the song, I'm gonna see what fits?
No, I think the drum machine is definitely a part of it for me. And I didn't do it from the beginning. I mean, definitely my first album, I didn't write with a drum machine. The second one, I think it was the first one that actually I started using a drum machine for writing. Because it's just kind of, it does start, I just start playing over a beat, and that kind of takes me, you know, even I need to have a phrase also. I can't just start writing with nothing, but if I have a little phrase or a couple of things written down lyric-wise, I'll start working with that, and then with that I'll start finish. You know, I don't ever write a whole lyric and then sit down to do the music or vice versa. I kind of do it all together. But I think definitely the drum machine is a part of it. It's sort of like to get around to starting, you know, a chord progression or something, and then the drum machine is definitely something that I do enjoy.
Do you prefer the drum machine when you're creative, or does it sometimes feel better to be like with live musicians in the creative process?
Oh, I'm too shy. I can never come up with stuff with other people around. I mean, not with a band playing. It's right. I'm even nervous of improvising. It's like, you know, I'm just very, very shy. So it has to be something machine-ish, something automatic that I can just turn off and stuff.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, I'm Karen Sabina, and I come from Huaynum Park High School. Hi. And my question for you would be, what do you like the best of your career? Like, is it you singing to the public, or is it you writing your songs, or what is it that you like the most?
Well, I have to say that this is like the first time in my life that I can say I like everything about it, because when I put my first album out, I hated touring. I actually canceled shows because I didn't want to do more, which was pretty silly, but I did. And I think in the second album, I was enjoying being in the studio more than going on tour, and it's been always changing around, but at this point in my life, I feel very privileged and happy and lucky to be able to do what I'm doing, which is I can do something and invent myself something at home and then put it together and then record it and then put it out and tour with it and have people come to the shows. It's just like, it's great. It actually, and also I just like, and with something that I've always liked since I started writing is the fact of writing. Just sitting down and writing a song will, what I said before about endorphins, it really is. I mean, you do feel like, yeah. You know, it is like, you feel happy, I feel happy, and I feel like it's very therapeutic, you know? It's like, and so that's something that's always been constant about, you know, what I love about being able to do this.
So you would never regret the fact that you chose this career?
No, actually, I think it chose me, but no, definitely not. I actually feel that I'm very lucky, and I'm really, soy como muy agradecida, sabes? Very, muy agradecida, no sé cómo se dice en inglés, eso.
Very grateful.
Yes, very grateful.
Thank you.
All right, thanks.
Hello, my name is Fernando Chavez from San Diego, and I'm
Hello.
The song that closes out the movie Maria Full of Grace, I've been trying to acquire that song and I just can't find it anywhere.
Yeah, I think the soundtrack never came out. So
yeah, it never came out.
Yeah, it didn't. Wow, I don't know. I don't even have a copy
Hook
of it.
Up.
That's pretty bad. I don't know, and I'm sorry. I haven't played it in years. I only played it when I recorded it. I never actually played. I'm sorry.
I guess I'm just going to buy the DVD to have it on there.
There you go. Yeah.
But yeah, but I really wanted to get a copy of it.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that. Yeah. No, I don't. I can't help.
She's got some bootlegs in the trunk of the car. So afterward, we'll hook you up.
All right. Thank you.
There are people up there I didn't realize. I apologize. Maybe some folks up on the balcony.
Hi, Julieta. That's an honor. My name is Carla Martinez, and I'm from Azusa Pacific University. And my question for you, Cougars. My question for you is, what contributed to your desire to play the accordion, and who were some of your influences in playing in that unique style that you do?
Well, I think that I was really curious about the accordion because it was always around. You know, being from Tijuana, you kind of always heard it, and but I never. It was when I started playing it. I wasn't thinking of norteño music. I mean, I listened to Los Tigres all the time, but for some reason, it was like I was always looking somewhere else, and I saw and I liked Tom Waits, who used it a lot, and. Joe Jackson used it in a couple of albums, and I actually saw him once live, and he was using it, and I was like, well, I really want to try this. I think it took me some time, actually a few years, to realize that what I love and what I love about the accordion now most is the festivity that it can that you can get out of it. So the norteño side is basically what I enjoy most, you know? It's like, you know, like the... You know, just kind of like I really enjoy it, and but I think when I started playing it, I really enjoyed more like the melancholic side of it. But now it's more just like the party of it, you know.
Yeah, thank you. You made me enjoy that really much.
How about on this side up top?
Hi, I'm Pam Hernandez, and I lived in Mexico City for 10 years, and I used to listen to your music all the time there. ¿Alguna vez pensaste que tu música se iba a escuchar en México y en los Estados Unidos también?
No, la verdad que no. I think, ¿te lo contesto en español o en inglés? Que no sé.
En lo que quieras.
Ah, okay.
Los dos hablo perfecto.
Ah, ok, eso. creo que cuando todo lo que ha pasado en mi carrera y todo lo que ha... La manera en cómo ha ido sucediendo ha sido tan... inesperado para mí, o sea, no es algo que, no soy ni siquiera una persona que planea las cosas a futuro, ni que piensa futuro, ni que soy ambiciosa en el sentido de quiero hacer esto y lo hago, sino que dejo como un poco que las cosas que pasen, y eso es como ha ido como mi carrera como haciéndose. Soy obsesiva, compulsiva, la gente que me conoce, people who know me know that about me, o sea, saben que soy como que empiezo a hacer una cosa y la hago todo el tiempo, pero y creo que con la música soy así, pero no soy como de planear y de pensar. Entonces todo ha sido para mí como una sorpresa, todo ha sido como me están oyendo, ay, les está gustando, ay, o sea, como me dieron un premio, así, o sea, así, y todavía me sigue pasando. Yo creo que no me va a dejar de pasar eso de que me dan un premio y es como, se van a dar cuenta al rato que me lo tienen que quitar, como que se equivocaron o algo, pero prefiero también un poco como que vivirlo así, como sin creérmela mucho, porque lo hace más divertido. Como que no te esperes las cosas, ¿no?
Bueno. Gracias.
Bueno, nada.
So maybe we'll take two more questions and then we'll hear some songs.
Okay, sure. Okay.
Maybe one more in the front and one more.
Hi.
What happened?
¿De arriba también?
Yeah.
What? ¿Como que quieren más preguntas o no?
Acá, por acá.
Ah, que arriba.
All right. Up top.
El tercer piso.
In the good seats.
Exactly. Woo!
Yep. Pero, ¿qué van a preguntar ahí arriba?
Question up top.
Hello.
Bueno, Julieta. ¿Ah? Julieta.
¿Dónde estás?
Aquí estoy, el de verde aquí. So,
primero, aquí. Segundo, tercer piso.
Tercer piso, exacto.
Ah, ya te vi.
Aquí estoy.
Hola,
me llamo Elder y antes que nada... me da mucho gusto de tenerte aquí en USC. Yo estudio aquí arquitectura y bienvenida a Bovard.
Gracias.
Es un placer tenerte. Y ahora mi pregunta para ti es que yo siempre he notado que tienes una imagen así muy, muy humana, muy, muy noble, y aunque seas superestrella, superartista, siempre se me ha hecho como que tú siempre mantienes tus pies bien firmes en la tierra y la verdad admiro mucho eso de ti y pues le quiero, yo nada más quiero saber cómo la haces, o sea, si es algo que te enseñaron en tu familia, si son así, tus valores personales, no sé, cómo la haces para mantenerte tan así tan centrada y tan, pues, tan buena onda, en pocas palabras, ¿no?
No, pues gracias. Yo creo que sí tiene que ver con mi familia. En mi familia, o sea, es muy, muy chistoso porque como que siempre cuando me ha pasado algo bueno o malo o lo que sea en la vida o en no sé, en la música, en mi carrera, lo que sea, como que siempre como que lo agarramos un poco como que nos da risa. O sea, de repente es como, te dieron un Grammy. Así, o sea, nos reímos. No sé, es muy chistoso. Como que le quitan... para mí mi familia le da el valor a otras cosas, ¿sabes? No como al hecho de que de la fama o las cosas que son como externas a mí, sino las cosas que son cercanas a mí es lo importante. El hecho de sentirme agradecida porque la gente me escucha, el hecho de sentirme agradecida de hacer lo que amo más que nada en la vida, o sea, digo, no sé, la música para mí siempre ha sido como muy, muy importante. Y más que sentirme como la gran cosa, o sea, como me siento como, pues te da como mucha humildad que la gente acepte lo que tú haces y que te, sabes, como que te da mucho, yo siempre me siento como muy agradecida, no puedo decir lo suficiente y creo que es como lo más lejano a sentirme como, ah, es que ahora soy la más acá, o sea, nada, pues para nada, al contrario, o sea, realmente para mí me parece que sí me ha dado mucha humildad el hecho de que la gente me acepte, ¿sabes? Porque tampoco siento que soy artista en el sentido tradicional de, como entre comillas, artista. O sea, tampoco me gusta el juego, no sé si me explico bien, pero no juego el juego de ay, es que soy esto, entonces tú tienes que portarte de una manera y me tengo que portar de la otra, sino que pues es comunicación y es somos todos pues un poco igual, ¿no? Arriba, abajo del escenario. Lo que nos une es pues el hecho de que esa magia de la música también. No sé si me explica. ¿Me explica? Sí.
Gracias.
De 3 horas así, de tratando de cerrar la idea.
Is there a mic third on the third level on the right?
Joe.
Hello. All right.
There we are. You are.
Hey. Over here, on your right.
Hola. Hi.
Hey, how's it going? My name's Hugo, and I'm a student here at USC. I just want to start off by saying that your shows are great. I've seen you in concerts many, many times, and probably one of my favorites was the last time you came at the Nokia Theater and you did the Unplugged show.
Oh,
it was
thanks.
Great. I guess my question to you is, you obviously play a variety of instruments. You play guitar, accordion, piano, and that's... You probably play more that we're not aware of, but what's your favorite instrument to play in front of a live audience? Is there something that you like, you know, more than the others?
Well, it's funny because in front of an audience with a show, like a whole show, I think it's the accordion because it's, and that's basically why I started playing. I think I wanted to get away from the piano and just kind of like stand up and como mirar de frente a la gente, and it's something that, but the piano is the instrument that I play at home, that I'm playing all the time, and actually when Josh told me about doing this tonight, I really wanted to do it in the piano because that's the instrument that I play the most at home, and it's just, I really enjoy playing it, but when I'm playing in front of a crowd, I do enjoy just like the, I think the accordion, in its own nerdy way, is actually pretty rock, so, you know.
Okay, thank you. And you look nice today, by the way, even from up here.
Thanks.
Is it on? Julieta, my name is Cynthia Alvarez. I'm a PhD student on the other side of the freeway at UCLA. So my question might be slightly premature, being that the show is not yet over, but I was wondering, what direction do you see your music going from now? You just said that you're not much of a planner, but what mood do you feel in now, if you're writing at all?
You know, when I finished a tour, I finished a tour in the middle of December, and I think the whole process of putting the record together and touring it was a year. It wasn't a year, yeah.
It was
right?
A long tour.
Yeah, it was a long tour. I mean, because the thing is that the tour for the Unplugged was actually only like 6 months, which is, you know, shorter than the last two tours that I did. But when I finished the whole thing, I realized that I had been touring records for like 5 years. So I was a C. I put C out, and then I did a tour, and then I finished the tour, and I started writing, and then put Limonizala, and then I toured again for a couple of years. And so when I finished this whole process, I realized that I was kind of like really tired. It's like, but I was tired, not physically, but just emotionally. You kind of start putting everything out all the time, como la carne del asador, como le decimos, como all the time. And then when I finished, it was like, I just want to sit in my house, read and play the piano, and I have no idea what I'm gonna do. I'm serious. I started sort of, como muy tímidamente, más o menos, me escribir un par de canciones, but I'm not full on writing yet. It's just, I want to give it a couple of months of just like not doing anything. I'm doing really silly stuff. I'm, you know, taking Portuguese lessons. I know it's really hard to say it. But I really like Portuguese, and I've always wanted to learn it. So, you know, now I'm doing that. I'm swimming and doing yoga, and I don't know how long it's going to be. But, you know, that kind of stuff. And I feel like doing that for a few months. And I'm sure that in that process, I'll probably start writing. But I really have no idea yet. I really want to take it easy a little bit.
Thank you. Good luck.
Thank you. All right. Thanks.
Hopefully soon you'll start. I think they're offering them in Mexico City now. They're yoga classes in Portuguese, which would be really,
really?
Yeah. Which I think we'd all like to.
I'll definitely
to
go
witness.
For that. Yeah.
That would be great.
They have a client.
Yeah.
Hi, Julieta. My name is Karina Moreno. I'm an alumni from Loyola Marymount. Go Lions. There's any Lions.
Yeah.
First of all, I wanted to say that te adoro. I love you so much, and thank you so much for your music. I think it resonates with so many women here. Just when you were talking about Me Voy and how you were saying how you were pounding it. And when I'm in my car, I am literally going like this. But my question to you is, ¿qué son los sueños para Julieta? What are your dreams? What's next?
Well, I've always, in the last few years, I feel like I'm always kind of living in a little bit, sort of like living in a dream, you know, in a way. And at the same time, I just, like I was telling Josh before, I feel like you keep on sort of like pushing the limits a little bit more and see where that takes you. And I hope that can keep on going on, you know, I can keep on discovering things that I don't know and learning things that I don't know, because I'm sure that there's a lot of stuff that I haven't learned yet. So I really would like to be able to and have a chance to do that and kind of keep on mixing it up. And so, you know, we'll see. I mean, that's basically what I would like to just kind of keep on learning stuff from this, you know, and sharing it also.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Julieta, speaking of the new songs, would you play the new songs you wrote for the Unplugged?
See.
The three, there are three, right?
Yeah, I did three.
Would you guys like to hear those? Yeah? Thank you.
Okay, this is one of the songs that I did, one of the new songs. I wrote this for my little sister. She's not here, but I was thinking that she's living in LA, so I think she was gonna be here and I was gonna like...
And your little sister attends what school?
What?
What school does your
little... Oh, no, never mind. She goes to a school somewhere in the city. I'm not even gonna say the name, but... but anyway, I wrote this I don't know if you have like really young sisters, but she's 21, and I really, I've always thought about her, how I don't want her to make like the mistakes that I've done, or I want her to be happy and just have this like super great life. And this song I wrote about that, about wanting her to be happy, but then realizing that everybody, we are all here, como que todos estamos aquí para cometer nuestros errores solos, you know, to make our own mistakes. So this is basically what the song is about. It's called Algún Día. And I'm not going to do the whole, I could do it all just upbeat, but I think I'm going to do it like really piano-y, low.
¶¶
decirte algo que sea importante, algo hecho con sabiduría. Algún día sabré un poco más de lo que sé, poco a poco tropezando menos. Ojalá el tiempo sirva de algo. Mientras tanto vamos todos en el mismo tren, cometiendo errores y pisando mal. Mientras tanto vamos en este vaivén que nos lleva y trae pisando mal. Quizás el paso del tiempo nos enseñe algo. No te puedo engañar, decir que sé más de lo que es. Todo lo hago por cuidarte, esa es mi mayor preocupación. Algún día quizás podré ayudarte en algo. Será mi regalo que te puedo dar. Mientras tanto vamos todos en el mismo tren, cometiendo errores y pisando mal. Mientras tanto vamos en este vaivén que nos lleva y trae pisando mal. Déjame discutirte, déjame discutirte, déjame decirte, déjame decirte, déjame discutirte, déjame discutirte, déjame, déjame. Mientras tanto vamos todos en el mismo tren, cometiendo errores y pisando mal. Mientras tanto vamos en este vaivén lleva y trae pisando mal. Quizás el paso del tiempo nos enseñe algo. El paso del tiempo nos enseñe algo.
Gracias. I mess them up a lot. I'm kind of like, okay.
Which one?
No, porque las que como que me equivoco mucho. una más de las de esta.
Sure.
Okay. A ver cómo me sale, es que no sé cómo me sale, bueno, a ver. Es que no sé cómo tocarla al presente.
El presente.
Bueno, pero si la cantan, ¿no? Porque pues también no es lo mismo tocarla con mi trillo, por lo menos, que aquí.
If Julieta sings al presente, can we get some help?
What?
Some help from the audience? Sing along.
Pues, sí, ¿no? Ah. Puede empezar como tranquilita. Ya
pase lo que te diga no va a ser suficiente. Ay, 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 ay. Y lo que tú me entregues dejará pendientes. Ay, 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 ay. ¿Quién nos dice que la vida nos dará el tiempo necesario? Toma de mí lo que deseas, como si solo quedara el presente. Es lo único que tengo. El presente es lo único que hay. Es contigo mi vida, con quien puedo sentir que merece la pena vivir. Como base nos acaba todo. Ay, 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 ay. La tempestad y la calma casi son la misma cosa. Ay, 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 ay. ¿Quién nos dice que la vida nos dará el tiempo necesario? Toma de mí lo que deseas, como si solo quedara el presente. Es lo único que tengo. El presente es lo único que hay. Es contigo mi vida, con quien puedo sentir que merece la pena vivir. Sé lo que te diga no va a ser suficiente consuelo por perder este lugar que amamos y destrozamos. El presente es lo único que tengo. El presente es lo único que hay. Es contigo mi vida, con quien puedo sentir que merece la pena vivir.
Julieta Venegas. Thank you so much for joining us at USC and sharing your life and music. So, I'm sure there are some folks in the audience who might have seen a movie called The Heartbreak Kid. So there's this weird moment if you're watching The Heartbreak Kid with Ben Stiller, and all of a sudden Ben Stiller's driving south for his honeymoon in this fictional Mexico, and all of a sudden Julieta Venegas appears in the movie, a song called Eres Para Mí. I got it wrong. But now here's the thing. Well, that is Para Mí. There's no rap in the middle of the song in this version, right? Are you gonna, is the crowd gonna rap it? I'm not rapping it. All right. You're on your own.
Okay. You're pretty wimpy as singers, so you should try a little bit louder, maybe.
Eres para mí, me lo ha dicho el viento. Eres para mí, la agota. eres para mí. Me lo ha dicho el viento, eres para mí. La sombra que pasa, la luz que me abraza, tus ojos mirándome. La calle que canta su canto de diario, el mundo moviéndose. Yo sé que tienes miedo y no es un buen momento para ti y para esto que nos viene sucediendo. Pero eres para mí, me lo ha dicho el viento, eres para mí. Lo oigo todo el tiempo, eres para mí. Me lo ha dicho el viento, eres para mí. El espejo que da su reflejo en todo lo pinta tal como es. Mi cuerpo que no tiene peso, si escucho tu voz llamándome. Yo sé que tienes miedo y no es un buen momento para ti y para esto que nos viene sucediendo.
Should I try the rap? You don't want to do it?
Debes sentir más de la cuenta. El corazón es un músculo, si no late revienta, extraño. Mirarte de lejos, de hacernos los tontos, parecemos tan viejos. Tiempo, ¿quieres más tiempo? Mírame la piel, ¿no ves acaso lo que siento? Tú eres para mí, yo soy para ti. El viento me lo dijo con un soplo suave. Sí, yo sé que tienes miedo y no es un buen momento para ti y para esto que nos viene sucediendo. Pero eres para mí, me lo ha dicho el viento, eres para mí. Lo oigo todo el tiempo, eres para mí. Me lo ha dicho el viento, eres para mí. Tú eres para mí, yo soy para ti. Tú eres para mí, yo soy para ti. Tú eres para mí, yo soy para ti. Tú eres para mí, yo soy para ti.
Julieta Venegas. Thank you all for joining us tonight. Thank you for being here.